Net Radio. Miguel is our correspondent in Las Vegas. You can follow him at FightBeingMigs on both Instagram and YouTube. And Andrew Labouche is available on Facebook and AOL. That's funny. On AIM. He's on AIM, right? Wasn't
he? Yeah, instant message.
Instant message. He's available on instant message. My name's Lee Honish. Follow me on all forms of social media at Lee Honish. I am coming to you live from the lovely city of Kona, Hawaii. Fight Net Radio on the road. Anything going on with you, Miguel, over there in Lost Wages?
It's raining. It kind of got really cold all of a sudden and started to rain this morning. Apparently it rained last night a little bit, but yeah, I have my work set up looking out my window so I don't feel so cooped up. And this morning, 5 a.m., I noticed it started raining. It stopped, but it's still pretty damn cold. Other than that, not much.
I got videos of snow in Las Vegas. Miguel, you didn't see any snow today.
No, not from my angle, at least. I'm in North Las Vegas. I don't know where exactly the snow, but I did hear that it was supposed to snow. Yeah, it has snowed here before, crazy. But I didn't see any on my end, no.
Very nice.
Very nice. This show is about boxing. My name's Lee Honish. I am, I guess, one of the creators of this fine show that we bring to you each and every week. We'll jump into it, and we will pick up where we left off a week ago. If not, go visit our archives, no matter how you're seeing this, on our Facebook page or iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify. We're available on every platform. With that said, right where we left off last time, but I'll bring the story straight up, and I'll start with you, Andrew. Canelo Alvarez signed a two-year deal. I'm not going to go backwards on putting up the actual story at this moment, but Canelo Alvarez signed a two-fight deal with Eddie Hearn's in Match Boxing. So let's start right there. We didn't get to this story last week, so we'll pick it up right here and move forward from here. So he doesn't like Oscar, but he likes Eddie Hearn? Question mark?
That Eddie Hearn don't work for free. Canelo, seeing that it's not as easy being a promoter as he thought it was going to be, decided to throw that job on someone else. It's all of the above. Sad, you know, I think Oscar's kind of laughing somewhere. I don't know. It's got to be a love-hate relationship he has over this whole situation right now. But somewhere he's smiling because Canelo sort of failed, at least on the part of I'm leaving him to venture off and open my own thing and Canelo Promotions will be huge. No, your match room. So.
Miguel Antonio Barragán?
I think, you know, Canelo's kind of starting to figure out that it's not as easy as, you know, Floyd made it seem or Oscar made it seem or anyone else for that matter. So he's like, yeah, let me just go ahead and leave the, I think he's kind of burned his bridges with Oscar. So he's like, well, I guess I can't go back to Oscar. So he's going to, you know, he's going to go to Eddie Hearn and DAZN and whatnot. So I don't think it was a matter of him having issues with them. Because, I mean, we're not sure how much, like, I don't know what the amount is that he's going to be paid for these fights here with DAZN. But I don't think it was a matter of money when they were asking him for a discount before. I think it was just, you know, him looking for a way out of his Oscar contract. And he got it. So, he's fine. He has no problem with Eddie. No problem with DAZN, I'm sure.
I think he was definitely power hungry to get the move out of the De La Hoya contract. And it's look at where it left him. Now it left him, you know, basically asking Eddie Hearn to help him out and looking a little bit foolish. You didn't see any of the other guys you just mentioned, Mayweather, De La Hoya, break off and then go, oh, you know what? Hey, Don, can you help us out? We left Bob, but we're kind of not getting this. No, you would think Canelo Promotions was going to, you know, take off. That was it. That's why he left Oscar. It's just a weird move. How it plays out, I don't know. But you know, like I said, I think Oscar, he's a little mad and happy still over this. He can't be too happy because Eddie Hearn's making the money that he should be making. Don't know why you left Oscar. You know, I do not get the whole situation. I think it was jealousy. And I still think, which is going to come up again later here, that he was pissed off about the Floyd Mayweather defeat. I think I don't know if Canelo, I think Canelo puts a lot of that loss on De La Hoya's decision to push him into that fight. Because Oscar not fighting for legacy. He was at one time, it kind of switched in his career, and he kind of turned into the guy that would take on anyone for any money. Canelo, I think Canelo sees how much that defeat has hurt him and is continuing to hurt him. And that pisses him off more than anything. So we will see. But I was kind of surprised seeing that he signed with Eddie Hearn so fast here after breaking off saying that he was going to start his own promotional company.
Which takes us to our next story. Sor V. Rungvinsai. How exciting. Sor V. Rungvinsai returns against Smith Sith Lord.
There you go.
Sor V. Rungvinsai, former two-time WBC world champion from Thailand, is set to get back in the ring on March 13th in Thailand. Shocker.
Hey, I like. How they did also known as. Go ahead. You'll get to it. That's going to be great for you.
Against former world champion and Thai super featherweight Kwanthai Sithmore Sang, a.k.a. Ekwak Sangwil.
Why are all these guys changing their names, man? What the fuck's up with this, Lee? There's a conspiracy here.
A.k.a. Ekawat?
Is he from Thailand? Because I know a lot of Thai boxers end up adopting the last name of their gym or something.
There you go. Yeah, that's some spy shit. Watch him.
It's not even easier to pronounce. It's like he made his name harder to pronounce.
Yeah.
The fight will be the main event of WP Boxing Series, or as I like to call it, somebody you've never heard of, the leading boxing program in Southeast Asia. Yeah.
Hey, you guys. Thor Rungvinsai. That's not even his real name, right? Doesn't he have another one too?
Oh, does he?
Yes.
Thor
Rungvinsai had another name too, and then they just started
by his middle name, which is what everybody can pronounce. But his first name is Barrett Siskrat.
Yeah. No. The whole thing was different. It's just like the guy under him. He had a totally different name. I forgot what it was, but he was going with a totally different name. Yeah, no, that's weird. I didn't know that it was about their gyms, though. That's good. Good knowledge.
I guess. Sor V. Rungvinsai returns. I start with you, Andrew Labiche. Excitement to see the former two-time champion?
No, because I don't want DAZN. I don't want them to turn this into the rematch with Estrada. You know what I'm saying? So, no, I want him to go away, man. Like, you lost to him. You got 5 defeats. You fucking eat rats. Like, I'm done with you.
No.
And he does. I'm not talking shit. The guy literally eats whole rats, Lee. His mom brings them to him at the airport, and he was chowing down on them. It's fucking gross.
Rats.
Whole rats, dude. She just deep fries, eh? Like fucking rat on a stick.
Deep fries rats. And so
Google it.
I want to follow your line of thought. Hold on. Your line of thought of not wanting to watch this fight is he eats deep-fried rats.
Kind of like elote? Like does it like mayo?
Yes, bro. Oh.
Hold on. We've had fighters drink their own urine, and now you're boycotting
the fight
because he eats rats.
Hey, you know what? That was for, what was it? The better of the sport.
I'm fascinated with your logic at this moment.
Juan Manuel Marquez, he sacrificed water for the sport, man. That's different than fucking grabbing a rat and deep frying that shit.
Where is it different? It's right up there.
I don't know. He didn't want any vitamins to be wasted. I don't
pop out of the toilet.
Yes. Something about nutrients.
Oh my God. That's so gross. Ah. I remember when he did it, I was eating dinner, and I was like, you better not fucking do it. You better not. Babe, look at what they're going to show. Oh, my God. Yep. Right there on HBO, drinking urine. Whatever.
It's Water World.
I feel sorry for all the little boxing kids that went into the bathroom and were like, well, I guess I got to do it.
Yes, I got to do it. If you're going to be a world championship boxer, you have to either eat rats or drink your own urine.
Oh, yeah.
And I see the title of this show. To be a world championship boxer, you must eat rats or drink urine.
You should.
Preferably.
So gross.
Miguel, Sorvi Rungvinsai, yes. Any interest?
I mean, half yes, half no. You know, he always Told has you. Knockout
You know
power.
It's a no.
Is it because just, he eats I mean, rats?
No, has nothing to do with eating rats. I mean, not that I would like to see him eat rats anyway, but nothing to do with that. That's his own diet. You know, that's his own prerogative. That's, you know, his dietitian. But it's just, I don't know, like, I kind of feel like he had his little 15 minutes of fame, you know, when he took out Chocolatito, and then, you know, his fights with Estrada. But that's pretty much it. Like, he's kind of a one-trick pony. You know, he has that power. That's pretty much it. Once they figure it out, that's essentially it. So it's fun to see him because, you know, he still has that power and he can always knock someone's block off. But once I see him losing to these dudes, I mean, he beat, you know, Chocolatito, so maybe he can beat him again. But there's just no point at this point. I'm kind of over him already.
Hey, yeah, if you go to his box rec, it does have his original birth name there. They both start with the W. I can't Wangik is his real last name. Yeah, but I was trying to look up him eating rats. Let me look, and I'll send you a photo.
Hey, thanks for sharing for us the rat. Joining us on the phone is Jessica McCaskill to talk about our next story. Hey!
Oh, Clarissa. Yeah, you never
stop. For everybody who's watching the video, see, you can see me doing it this time. It's much more fun that way, isn't it?
It is.
That's right. We're talking about the Estrada Chocolito undercard. Jessica McCaskill is taking on Cecilia Brakus. They will rematch for the undisputed female welterweight title. If you didn't know, they fought once before to nobody watching it whatsoever. So the fact that they're having a rematch means nothing. Also on the card is a guy named Hiroto Kiyoguchi. He's going to defend his WBA light flyweight title against Axel. The reason I'm not giving last names is we don't know pretty much anything about these four fighters. And the truth is you're only watching it for Estrada versus Gonzalez. Any interest in Brakus McCaskill 2, Miguel?
If it's, I mean, it's going to be most likely on DAZN. I do have DAZN. So yeah, I'm going to tune in to watch primarily for the, you know, the main event. Of course, I may kind of, pay attention to the undercard. You know, the Brakus and McCaskill, they fought once before in a pretty close fight, but, I didn't like the way Cecilia sounded at the end of the fight. You know, she was like interviewed after the fight and she sounded more happy for McCaskill than you know, upset about the loss because she lost her undisputed title. And it kind of sounded like she was kind of already on the way out talking about handing the, you know, the what is it, the torch, passing the torch kind of deal. But I'm glad that there's going to be a rematch. At least she gets a chance to get her title back. I'll watch. Yeah, I'll watch.
Andrew?
Definitely watch the fight. It was a pretty good first fight, and with it being to the co-main event to an exciting main event, as in Gonzalez and Estrada, why not? So yeah, but I do agree with Miguel. I thought Brakus was. I thought she retired that night. She did seem like she was very humble with the decision, just at peace with everything she had done. So to see her come back, hopefully this is not just a money grab because. She's gonna have a rough time in there if her heart's not totally in it.
Well, just because this just in, and I like doing this just in.
Hey, there it is. Totally.
Wow, look at that tail.
That's a full wrap.
A la Sorvi Rungvinsai.
And mashed potatoes, or is that rice?
That's one of
rice. Yeah.
Rice.
Right. Yeah. You always eat rat with rice.
Oh, he's got two rats. Please. He's got one on the plate in his hand.
Rat and rice go together.
Holy hell.
I don't even know about it. That's literally
that tail is stiff as hell. Look at that. That's fried. Wow.
Wow is beyond right. I mean, that's moving.
There's some people that would be like, I'm glad you moved into our apartments.
Exactly. You don't have to pay rent.
Dana White handicaps the Mayweather versus Paul match. Why would you ask? Do we want Dana White's opinion? Why not? This is going to be such a one-sided, ridiculous ass-whooping, it's not even going to be funny. That's Dana White pulling no punches on upcoming Floyd Mayweather versus Logan Paul fight, warning to the YouTube star, straight up, you're going to get hurt. It's going to be bad.
Dog.
I'm open for, and I don't like any one side, one of these kids, but if Floyd Mayweather really shows up and goes into this fight, this kid is going to be an ass whooping like nobody has ever seen before. 25-year-old Logan is set to meet the 43-year-old Floyd on February 20th in an exhibition pay-per-view. He went on to say, Logan's going to find out what speed is. Speed is power. When you get hit with shit that you don't see coming, and when a guy like Floyd Mayweather starts putting it on you, it's not even going to be a fight. It's going to be ridiculous. It's going to be the worst ass whooping you've ever seen. Take the size difference and all the other things. It's going to look like what a grown man can do to a kid. I ask you first, Andrew, do you agree with Dana White? And trust me, this is an audio clip I'm about to post. So let me do it again. Andrew, do you agree with Dana White?
Yeah, to a certain extent, yes. Yeah, we got to put in the factor that it's not a real fight. Floyd does toy around. We watched what he did with McGregor. So I'm not convinced that Floyd's going to go in there and try to take this guy out in a matter of rounds. I'm off of that train with Floyd Mayweather, the whole he's going to knock you out thing. It'll probably go the distance. It'll probably be Floyd schooling him, yes. But I don't know how much power Floyd's actually going to put into the punches when he's throwing them on this guy. I think this is all for show. It's for money.
Miguel.
Yeah, I think they're overlooking the fact that this is an exhibition. I mean, for all I know, they're going to throw, you know, nothing but body shots, just the way, Tyson and Roy Jones did. So, I think the only time Floyd, like, I think we've all experienced this, you know, when you're sparring with somebody and you accidentally throw something a little too hard and then they throw one back at you to, like, check you, that's probably as hard as we're all going to see, you know. Maybe Paul will get a little bit overzealous and throw a punch harder than he probably should have, and Floyd will check him, you know, with a harder punch. It'll be like, all right, dude, tone it down. This is an exhibition. And that's really as far as it's going to be. It's not going to be no ass whooping. They're probably going to try to give us, you know, our money's worth and go
the distance.
Don't
watch.
Downs. Yeah, right, exactly. Don't order the shit on pay-per-view.
Don't watch.
Whatever you do, don't order it. But, I mean, it's not going to be an actual ass-whipping. Let's be real here. It's an exhibition.
Yeah. With that said, hey, everyone, did you know there was boxing this weekend? I sure as heck did, and I sure as heck didn't watch, and I'm pretty sure Andrew didn't watch. But let's just go out on a limb. Fulton defeats Leo for the WBO super bantamweight title that literally nobody really cared about, at least in my camp or Andrew's camp. But let's try a real diehard. Miguel, did you watch this fight?
Yes, I did.
Of course
I did catch it. Yes, of course I did. Thankfully, it was the same. I mean, it was the same night as the UFC card this weekend, but it was before the main event. So, you know, whatever, you know, undercard bouts were on, I was able to focus on this one. I caught some of the undercard, but this one in particular, because this guy, Angelo Leo, he's from Vegas. He trains here and he's a local guy. So I try to support him and tune in.
He's Leo the Lion. He was in Creed, right?
Sure.
Okay. Sorry. I've gone with the joke for 2 weeks in a row. Clearly, it's not going to work with either of you.
I did catch it. It was a good win by Fulton. There was a lot of holding, more holding on Fulton's part. From the very beginning, Leo was putting a lot of pressure on Fulton and was pushing him back, kind of like with his shoulders and whatnot. And, Fulton was doing his best to kind of keep him at bay, but really more so, all he did was tie him up. The ref didn't seem too, interested in separating them. It almost let Fulton hold as much as he wanted to. And then because the referee didn't step in, Fulton would hold and then, like, let go of Leo and then crack him with a punch. And Leo's like, what the fuck? Is the referee not going to step in or not? So, I mean, regardless, Fulton won. It was pretty clear. Leo was just not able to keep up. But, it was a pretty entertaining fight. You know, Leo did what he could. You know, Fulton didn't come out of the fight unscathed, but he got himself a belt. So, and he kept his undefeated record. Good win for Fulton.
Andrew?
Gavin Newsom just lifted the stay-at-home order.
Yeah. You didn't know about that?
Can I go bowling now? Is it open tonight?
No, it's not opening, and that's not what he's opening. He's opening you can go back outside to go eat at a restaurant, Andrew. That's what he's opened.
Well,
it's like it was
before. You can eat while you bowl, so, I mean, maybe that counts.
You cannot bowl and eat.
Yeah, you can. Our bowling has eating in. We have a barbecue place and a snack bar, whatever you want to call it, and a bar.
Okay, well, take it. You didn't watch Showtime this weekend, even though you found out you still have Showtime.
Yeah, no, I didn't watch it.
Okay, well, let's on that same night, we got the premiere of a lightweight on the UFC. Did you watch UFC, Andrew?
No, fuck no. Oh my God.
Are you kidding? Conor McGregor.
Did you see that bump? Yeah. Oh, wow. What a shock. Conor McGregor lost. That's all he does nowadays. Fuck. Are you serious, people? That typical UFC fans. Oh, wow. Conor lost.
Okay. Quick takeaway at this moment, Miguel, was the debut of lightweight, what's his name from Bellator?
Oh, Michael Chandler.
Michael Chandler, who came in and basically took the number 6 overall guy and destroyed him, followed by the end, I would say the end of Conor McGregor. I don't know how you're a good fighter ending after you make $100 million. You're kind of
it's like a fourth ending of Conor McGregor.
Well, look, Andrew, he's still getting paid a couple of million dollars for real fights, unlike
because
Floyd.
Of the fan base of the UFC. That's all that's about. All right. Yes, you're right. And he'll continue to go to that octagon as long as they keep paying him the money to get knocked out. Come on.
Gil.
Whatever.
He did, like, well, according to my scorecard, because I pulled up the scorecard, he won the first round. He was doing quite well, actually. It wasn't until, like, Dustin was starting to land these low calf kicks that really started to fuck up his leg, kind of hurt his mobility. And once he wasn't able to move as much, Dustin was able to counter. And when he countered, he stuck him. And then he was like, oh, shit, he's not going anywhere. And he trapped him up against the corner and unloaded these shots. And it was an ass whooping. It wasn't that second round.
I didn't know leg kicks stopped you from lifting in your fucking hands. Pick up your goddamn hands.
Yeah,
how about that
too? Kind of. That too. I mean, he wasn't able to move out of the way.
Stop acting like you got some fucking head movement. You're some boxer. Ah, he looks so stupid. Putting the hands down. Peek. Oh shit. Peek. Oh, I'm really not missing anything. What a moron. No, don't blame it on the leg kicks. Blame it on the back.
But the leg kick helped to keep him from moving around. Yeah, it didn't keep him from lifting up his hands. But to be able to step back, the way, because we've seen him, he takes a step back to counter. Once he was having a hard time doing that, he was pretty much fucked. And Dustin knew that. So it
no
didn't help
that
he didn't keep his – yeah, exactly. It didn't help that his head movement was that. And it didn't help that he wasn't keeping his hands up. But furthermore, the fact that he wasn't actually get out of the way with his legs, that just was a dead sentence.
He watched too many fucking highlights of Saul Alvarez, man. He's like, I can do that.
Hey, here's a fun update. Now that Tampa Bay is the first team in 25 years to go to the Super Bowl in a host city, with Tom Brady, who's working very hard on being the greatest quarterback ever to play the game.
He is.
He is now officially, right? That did it. Yeah, yeah.
Dude, greatest quarterback. Yeah. Niner fans that scream Montana should just be happy that this young man was a Montana fan. Raiders that hate him should just be happy that we're the ones that catapulted his career. If the Raiders beat Tom Brady in that playoff game the first year, he might not get a second shot after Drew Bledsoe comes back from the injury. So maybe he does, maybe he doesn't, but it wouldn't have been guaranteed. When you win the motherfucking Super Bowl, it's almost guaranteed you're going to take the job. So the Raiders should be happy about that with him, and the Niners should be happy, and we should all move on. Because, see, Miguel, I'll give you a history on it. The Bay Area goes fucking nuts every time Tom Brady goes to the Super Bowl because Tom Brady's from San Mateo, California, and out here they all suck the dick of Joe Montana and the radios and everything. He was 4-0 in the Super Bowl. So they get all fucking crazy, and then the Raiders hate him because – you know, the snow job where they thought he fumbled. He did fumble. He fumbled the fucking ball. But, you know, the NFL gave him the ball back. And what we all Raider fans, and I was a victim of it too, I was guilty of it, is we don't remember there was like, I don't know, a whole quarter left in that game. We're just like, there was only a few minutes left, but I think it goes into overtime, right, Lee? Doesn't that game – I think that's what it was. It goes into OT.
Into overtime.
Yeah, so, you know, there was a little bit more game left, and we lost that part too, but fuck that. We only think of that one play, because if that one play would have went our way, then we would have won and everyone goes home, but whatever. Yeah, Tom Brady's greatest, man. It's amazing what he did, Lee. I watched that on Sunday. You know, I told Chris, it's just there's no argument anymore. We all need to stop. This guy goes, what, 9 times with one team. Everyone's like, oh, bullshit. It's because they cheat. It's because of Belichick. Literally goes to a fucking another team in a whole nother conference. Not even the same conference, Lee. It's not even like he's like, oh, I already knew this team. I already knew their playbooks. No, they put him in the NFC.
Brand new playbook too. Yeah. and basically the coach said, I just let him do whatever he really wants out there.
Well, you at this point, you got it. You can't act like you're coaching Tom Brady. Even Belichick called him last night and was like, you know, fuck. There goes a little bit of my Hall of Fame fucking speech out the window. Yeah, what are you going to say? His Hall of Fame speech now is going to be, I had Tom Brady. Fuck all of you guys. I'm going home. Because the man literally left me and went to the Super Bowl the next year with a new coach. It had nothing to do with me.
The host city, which has never been done before in the NFL history. And they will be taking on the Kansas City Chiefs. No shocker there. The number one team in the AFC runs the tables, basically. Excluding a couple of losses because I guess Patrick Mahomes was busy doing Allstate commercials in probably what will be the highest scoring game in the history of Super Bowls, my guess. I could be completely wrong, but I suspect this is going to be 100 points of scoring.
They only have the over-under at like 58, so you got to get on that.
You got to bet it now. You got to bet it now. The overs on both games this weekend were the bet, as I said on a different show. With all of that said, the reason I bring it up, and I go back to you, Miguel, hey, there's boxing this weekend. Our friend, undefeated IBF super middleweight world champion, Caleb Sweet Hands Plant, 20-0 with 12 KOs, defends against Caleb Golden Truax. On Fox on Saturday night to take up that space. So I start with you, Miguel. Hey, boxing, prime time, Fox, interested?
Yes. I mean, fights are fights. So yes, I don't have to, you know, have some sort of Showtime subscription or anything like that. It's going to be on Fox. So yeah, I'm going to tune in. I mean, to be honest, I'm not too excited about the fight. You know, even though all the talk that Caleb Plant has been, you know, talking about how I'm going to make it a short night, it's going to be quick, I'm going to take him out quick. I don't think he's that kind of fighter. I think he's the one that just takes his time and go the distance. So I would not be surprised if this fight goes the distance. And, you know, Truax is not top-notch competition, but the dude can take an ass whooping, so he can stand in there for 12 rounds. So I'm going to tune in to watch, of course, but we kind of already know what's going to happen.
8 years ago, he lost to Jermaine Taylor. 5 years ago, he lost to Daniel Jacobs. 4 years ago, Anthony Durrell. 2 years ago, James DeGale. Caleb Truax has never defeated anybody of any name. He's only lost to him. Nothing will change on Saturday night. It's a pathetic fight. Caleb Plant should be already a foughten. So Alvarez. He's pulled out of the fight twice with bullshit excuses. I don't care what they say. You don't fucking pull out of a fight with the best fighter in the world because you didn't have time to train or because you want to make more money. He better hope he wins on Saturday night, because if you lose to this guy who lost to Taylor 8 fucking years ago, you're a nobody. That $5 million you'll never make. That's all I got for him.
But it's going to be pretty sure. We're pretty sure that he's not going to lose. I mean, you know, granted, anything can happen.
But, anything can happen. That's right, bro. Anything can happen.
This one is a high unlikelihood.
He's a good fighter. He's a good boxer. I would love to see him fight Saul. But the excuses that he has given on why not to fight him is bullshit that he's taking on this dude. This is a giving, you know, like you said, this is a for sure win, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Easy paycheck. Like, come on. Are you serious right now? You could have fought. Hey, go look at what Andy Ruiz did. Follow Andy Ruiz, man. That's why he has $15 million in the fucking bank account. Not scared.
Mike
5 weeks. 5 weeks, Lee. He knocked out the heavyweight champ of the world. 5 weeks.
And then doubled his money in the rematch.
That's right.
More than doubled.
That's right. Go ahead. Sorry.
Center fielder for the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim, Mike Trout, now dipping his hat into the boxing world and immediately ranked by the WBA as the number two and number three light middleweight, is throwing it out there that he's willing to fight Tim Zhu, who's 17-0 with 13 KOs, and he's willing to fly to Australia. It would be great to come to Australia and fight Tim Zhu, told Peter Mantis. Who the fuck is Peter Mantis? I'm guessing of. And who, Ray Wheatley reported on Peter Mantis. Oh, never mind. Jeff Horn would be a good fight, but the payment would have to be right. Okay, so I start with you, Miguel. Are you interested in seeing a first ballot Hall of Famer, no doubt, Mike Trout, travel to Australia to fight Tim Zhu?
I would actually. Like, this is kind of what I was thinking as far as like the next step for Tim. A name he can put on his record that Trout is that big of a name, but he's big enough of a name.
But you're right.
Got enough of a name to be able to give more credibility and notoriety to Zhu. So this one seemed like it makes more sense. And he's a veteran. He's kind of on the downside of his career already, and he's more than willing to get the payday, fly over to Australia and Sue's home country and fight him there. So he's willing to do it, and that makes things a lot easier. I'm interested in it. I would like to see this kind of fight. I want to see if Zhu can take that next step, fighting a veteran that's going to be in there for 12 rounds, and see how he does against him. So I'm totally down for this one.
This fight works. We've brought up many names: Hoya, Martinez. Zhu is young, he's learning, and he's hot. He sells tickets. So you try to find opponents like this, guys that are on their way out, guys that are over the hill, but still have enough name that the fans would be interested in seeing their young lion, Zhu is that to Australia, go out there and compete. So, yeah, I love this fight. This is exactly...
not just enough of a name still, but still miles on the odometer, he's still got some, he's got a little bit of string left on him. So he's not totally, totally gone. Yes, he is on the downside, but he's still got a little bit to,
he's going
to
learn.
Yeah.
He's going to learn still fighting him. He's not peaked. We don't know who Zhu is. So this is still him climbing, beating a guy like Austin Trout. I'm totally into this fight too. That's it.
Yeah. There you go. All right, let's turn this now to the rumor mill. Hi, my name's Lee Honish. Welcome to Fight Net Radio. This is the rumor mill. None of these stories are confirmed or denied and haven't made it to a mainstream boxing website, but Andrew saw enough of it that we should discuss him. So let's start with Andrew's first. Davis versus Garcia has fallen apart, it seems. Andrew, we start with you on this. What do you know? Is that real?
I mean, if you follow the news, it was all over the news last week. It was kind of pathetic that we didn't have it in ours, but
it wasn't in the news feed at
yes,
all.
Yes, it was. These guys have been all over each other at doing the Tyson thing on the podcast, going back and forth on Instagram. And then out of nowhere, Ryan's like, not going to fight Davis, moving on, got bigger fights. I don't know. You can look it up. He tweeted out about not fighting him all of a sudden. Well, the rumor was that it was Jorge Linares, which you would think is, that's a good fight for Garcia, but is that really as big as what Gervonta Davis and him were about to be? Don't know. Well, now a few hours ago, or what was it, a day ago now maybe? Was it just yesterday that Ryan tweeted out the new news?
New news? New.
I think it was yesterday, actually. Yeah, yesterday.
It was yesterday.
Did you know that the state bird of Hawaii is
new story, Lee. There's a new rumor. And the new rumor is that this fucking guy is fighting Manny Pacquiao next.
I understand that. We're going to get to that as our featured story because, hold your horses on that one. Let's take to the other rumor mill story that's out there because it's not confirmed and it's not even a signed fight, for God's sakes. Let's talk about Anthony Joshua versus Tyson Fury. As stated before via Bob Arum, is the fight signed? In principle, both parties have come to a number that agrees to both sides that might consider a real number and then therefore consider it to real paper. And that makes for a real fight because we've actually had discussions on the topic. Yeah. $200 million.
That's your question, right? 200 million. That's what these guys want. Andrew, $200 million? Is it worth $200 million in a COVID era fight?
Yes. Yes, because of location. Location, location, location. And it's going to Dubai. And if the fight happens in Dubai, then $200 million is not expensive for them at all. I think you can play for that in the airport when you get off of the airlines and out there. So
for the gold bar and
the gold bar, you only get a finger or two to lift, which I heard someone did complete. It has been done. Someone fucking did it, but I wasn't there. That's just what I heard. So yeah, Lee, no, the fight could very well happen. Listen, that's big money, dude. People don't pass on that type of money. 100 million each. And that's not even for including the rematch that they'll probably be doing and making another $200 million total, if not each. So yeah, I'm totally into this fight. We know how much pool Joshua has in Dubai. Hell, even Tyson Fury has posted videos of him being out there. These guys are big right now everywhere. I think the fight's a lot closer than people are giving it credit for.
Miguel.
Yeah, that was one of the rumors, right, that it's going to go over there to Dubai. This last weekend's UFC was in Abu Dhabi, and they had a small arena with roughly 2,600 people in there. If they can do something similar but with a larger arena, over there in Abu or Dubai, they can, get some gate better than none, in addition to their, $200 million each. That's the word, I guess, going around. There's a pretty, pretty good chance it's going to happen over there, because right now it's not going to happen in the UK. It's not going to happen here. Where else can, shell out that kind of cash and have a gate to some extent?
There you go.
Look at that.
Whoa. That's the guy getting the gold bar out. Just there. There you go. Yeah. Glad we could have that as a segment on the show. Unbelievable.
And then right after
which
that,
takes
he was shot.
Yeah, exactly.
He was shot.
He was robbed.
He was found on domestic terrorism charges, which takes us to our featured story. Ryan Garcia, back off his craziness and moving on to his next hypothetical fight, has put out banners, and it's made it all over the news. There is no confirmation on this whatsoever. It would be considered a rumor. However, somebody went to the really tough trouble of making this cool-looking poster that I'm sure probably took about as much time as me airbrushing, Bernie into our logo shot that's available at fight.net.radio on Facebook. So I'll start with you, Andrew. Would you even want to see this fight? Because according to Ryan Garcia, hashtag blessed, hashtag mentor mentee, hashtag can't wait, hashtag. So I start with you.
We would need the details of where the fight's taking place. What weight is it going to be taking place at? Look, Ryan has speed. He has power in the left hook. Does he have the experience? No. To take on someone like Manny. Does he have the chin? Didn't seem like it in his last fight. So there'd be a lot of question marks going in. Definitely this goes back to I would be surprised if the Reynosos and Canelo would allow Garcia to move forward with this fight because of their experience they had with Floyd and how much that has dampened their growth in the sport with the casual fans, being a crossover here in America. You lose to Manny Pacquiao. A lot of casuals are going to remember that. Don't know if there's a name for Garcia, even throwing Terence Crawford and Spence in, just to say, you guys, if he goes the welterweight, because the kid is 5'10", he's tall. Reynosos, they look like they know how to put weight on fighters, even if it is just from the fucking steak that's being delivered out there. I don't know what's going on, but they do seem to beef up nicely in their stable. So maybe he puts on the weight and moves the welterweight. There's not a name that surpasses Pacquiao right now with casuals, so it would really damper Garcia's career if he is to lose, and especially if he's to lose by knockout, which could very well be a possibility because of the fact that he's so young, and Manny, he's just a He's a fucking tornado, right? He just keeps coming, and that could mentally break Garcia in the fight. Bad look for the beginning of your career.
Andrew, you'll never believe this. Joining us in the studio is, of course, longtime promoter of Manny Pacquiao, Bob Arum.
Hey.
Bob, do you just grunt at this point? Like, is that what the caricatures really come down to? Just,
Yeah.
Thanks, Bob.
What?
Got to stop the Steve Austin thing.
What?
Bob, what do you think about this fight?
Shit. You should have fought Terence Crawford. That's all there is to it. He's over the hill. He's washed up. He's fighting two-bit PBC fighters. Should have fought Terence Crawford for the $5 million I offered him.
$5 million, Bob? That's all he was worth?
That's all he's worth. He's a shot fighter. Take steroids. What an asshole.
Thank you for that insight. I turn to you, Miguel. Would you get behind this insanity?
Well, insanity is probably the best way to describe it. It's definitely too much of a leap too soon. I mean, that I don't think I need that. That goes without saying, right? I don't know how much credibility this has. I mean, this is just a rumor, of course, at the moment. But realistically, most likely Manny can still drop to 140. I would think that might be where this fight will take place at 140, because, you know, just one division between the two at that point. You know, Ryan would just move up to 140 at that point, because he does have the height. So I think if that happens realistically, that there's where it's going to take place. It's definitely a bad idea. Manny is going to dance circles around fucking Ryan, you know, at this point. Even at his age, 41 or whatever he'll be by the time the fight comes around, if it happens, he will dance circles with him. We know Ryan has never faced somebody like this, not just with the power, but speed. That left hand of his, and, you know, later on in his career, Manny Pacquiao, the IQ.
Just the IQ, man.
Exactly. To be able to handle that, what Manny added later to his repertoire, that right hook, in addition to that, that's going to be too much. I think just looking at the way Ryan, I mean, not to put too much into that Campbell fight, but just the way Ryan got stuck with that left, Manny would, like, make him freeze like a deer in the fucking headlights, you know, with his movement alone. Feints, everything from the clinches. I mean, everything. He's just far, far too experienced and still has plenty of pop in that left hand. It would be a bad idea, because he will, like, clothesline him over the top rope. And let's be real here. This is how bad it will happen. But, ballsy on Ryan's part. You know, he's going to try to do it. I don't understand why people around him are just saying, like, he's got too many yes people around him, letting him do this shit, instead of checking and be like, no, dude, we still got plenty of people down here. You know,
I got one answer. It's fucking Oscar, man. Oscar has always put all of his fighters on the same level that he was, or they're supposed to be on the same level that he was, and it's just not like that. There's not too many Oscar De La Hoyas walking around, and Oscar's never gotten that about this sport. I don't know if it's something that he likes proving to himself, or proving to his dad, or proving to the boxing world in general, but he loved doing that to all of his guys. If you look when Golden Boy first started, they used to go through undefeated fighters or take bad decisions all the time, just putting guys in fights that they didn't belong in. This would not be a surprise if De La Hoya goes ahead and allows him to fight Pacquiao. Remember, Oscar took on Chavez. What was Chavez, 96-1, 98-1, a WBC champ. He takes him on with like 20 wins. Stops him in four rounds, even though I thought the cut was already there. I mean, that's not the issue. The issue is he stopped him in four rounds. Hey, 96-1.
Bro.
So and he's every it, Chavez is every bit of Pacquiao at that time.
Yeah. Hey, I'm gonna explain it, bro. Okay.
Oh, you're a money whore. Nothing to explain.
Hey, fuck you.
No, well, that's what you are. Everyone knows it. That's not a surprise on why he goes.
I'm a whore, yes. Money,
yeah. No, whore. Money whore.
I have never put money inside my body for whores. Okay, maybe spoons and utensils, but never money. Okay, get it right, bro. Listen, Pacquiao won't fight me. He's afraid of me. That's what I'm saying.
You're right. So I won't be surprised if this fight happens. It's going to be fucked up, man. Garcia was doing fine at the lightweights. We had something building nice there. Yeah. I hope they don't throw a wrench in it like this, where they move Garcia way too fast. Did you guys see the meme where the kid is like clearing four steps at one time? And they put, this is Garcia. No. One step says unify or defend. Mm-hmm. Next step says unify. Next step says driver's license, circumcision.
Oh, geez. It's a bad idea. I mean, we all know it's a bad idea. Come on now. Like, it's having a hop. There's plenty to do at 135. Hell, even if he wants to go to 140, for fuck's sake, there's plenty to do there too. It's just like, this is just a really, it feels desperate. It feels like a desperate.
It feels like real desperate.
Grab. Like real cash grab. You know, it's, dude, just like, come on now. It isn't necessary.
It's like they sat in an office and was like, Teofimo is getting all the awards because he beat Lomachenko. What can we do? Yeah. Dude, fight Lomachenko. That's a big move for Garcia's career right now. Fight Linares. This is a huge. Davis, huge. All these are huge. Pacquiao, yeah. Suicide. What the fuck? Let's go to Pacquiao. Yeah, that's the answer. And, hey, listen, but he did it, and he got away with it for a long time, and that's why he does this to his guys. Yeah, what? Oh, he probably tells, oh, did you see who I was fighting when I was only 20 years old?
Joining us on the line is Al Haymon to discuss the fight.
Do you know, Ali, yes. Did you know Oscar De La Hoya? Maybe you told me this. You might have told me this in your
might have.
Your what were those things you were giving us? Quizzes or whatever?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Never fought a man with a losing record. That's him even coming out of the Olympics. He never fights a guy with a losing record in his whole career. It's pretty good, man. That's what he expects out of all of his guys.
Joining us on the line, PBC owner, director, and often recluse, Al Haymon.
I'm going to get some
coffee. Discuss Manny Pacquiao versus Ryan Garcia. Hey!
Miss Shields. Miss Shields.
How much is Breakus making?
More than you, I'm sure. I'm sure. Oh.
Did you see I made a calendar?
Why'd you make a calendar? What the fuck?
And a video? I'm doing workout videos.
Oh, well, I hope that supplements your income.
Yeah. Hey.
Oh, yeah.
That'll do it for this week's Fight Net Radio extravaganza that brings you completely up to date on the wonderful world of boxing. Did I miss anything, Andrew? Did I?
I don't know. Go to Fight News and check. Make sure you got everything.
I did, Andrew.
Go to Boxing Scene and check.
The only thing that I missed was a non-story in Sullivan Barrera dropping the 168-pound division title, and that's just because he's a piece of crap. He spent most of the year training for his showdown.
Sergey got popped again. Sergey got popped again. Yeah, he failed another test. Yep.
Yeah, but didn't we cover that last week? Wasn't there a rumor?
He failed again. There's two tests now.
This is the second time. Okay, then I blew it. Yeah, okay, so for those of you who don't know, Sergey Kovalev, who we reported a week ago, got popped once, has now gotten twicely popped, where Oscar said the fight might be off, I don't know. Now it's definitely off because he's gotten popped twice because they were waiting for the second test, or testing the B sample is probably what occurred, which caused Sullivan Barrera to drop his 168-pound belt. Okay. I guess. I don't. Who cares about Sullivan Barrera to begin with? But all right, let's just put it all into perspective. I'll start with you, Miguel. One, Sergey Kovalev, A sample and B sample are now positive. Shockers on that. And question number two, Sullivan Barrera, an afterthought at the 168 division. Any interest or anything about him dropping his title?
No, not really. I mean, like, what is it dropping it for? I'm reading it here. Is it going to move up to light heavyweight or hold on, light heavyweight contestant number race? Where is he at right now? He dropping.
He's going to move down in weight.
What the?
To go after Benavidez, dropping. Plant, Sanders.
Oh, well, that's not a bad idea. I mean, I don't know how much interest people have in Sullivan in general, but I mean, dropping down there. I mean, there's definitely more fights for him available there. That's not a bad idea. I don't know if he can, you know, how much. that's going to affect him, having to drop back down, because that generally affects fighters, you know, when they move up in a weight division, fight, and then have to come back down again. I'm willing to see how he looks at 168, but that's not a bad move for him because, you know, there's definitely more money fights at 168, I would say.
Andrew Lapche.
Yeah, there's nothing. Fernando Vargas's second son has turned pro, so Fernando Vargas now has two sons that are fighting professionally. Haney
what about
says,
the other 20 kids that he doesn't know
hey,
about
hey, check
yet?
This
any
out.
Any word on any of them?
Wait about, I don't know about them, what? But these two are fighting. Now, what about this? David Haney says Floyd's training like he's going to fight a top welterweight. Now, we know it's about the Jake
no,
Paul
No, he's
thing.
Not. He's fighting a Logan a or Joe, a Paul or whatever
Paul,
they are.
Paul Logan? Paul Logan.
Logan's.
Paul Logan Sicken. Paul. They're wait, Pauls. Wait, Paul? They're technically okay, Paul. Pauls. Yes. Yeah.
There are two Pauls.
Do you guys think Floyd...
That I would do it? Yes,
wait,
I
no,
would.
Wait, no. Wait, wait. Oh. We know all that Floyd's missing in his career is the middleweight run. I've been talking about this forever. The middleweight run. Hmm. Now that it seems Jaime Munguia is on his way possibly fighting Triple G, do you think there's room, there's an avenue there for Floyd to come back and try to make a run at that winner?
No. Were a lot of easy fights for Floyd to make money. It's about money.
Yes, you know what? Here's the thing. Here's the funny part. He actually tweeted or put on his Instagram page. He was pretty much butthurt that Conor McGregor was getting so much love from his fans, even after losing. And he's like, "Why does everybody hate me?" And everybody, he made it a race thing and all this other shit. Like people liked him or didn't hated him because he's black. Like it has anything to do with it. And talking about, you know, pretty much being butthurt because people are supporting Conor even after losing. And
he got one thing right. People they're both hated and loved for the same reason. Conor McGregor's an asshole, and white people love an asshole, especially their own. People hate Floyd because he's an asshole, and people hate assholes. So he's kind of partially right.
Well, he's partially right, but let's be real. He created this persona. They both did. So fuck that. So there's, you know, first inclination that he's cares about anything other than money. But let's be real here. He cares more about money than anything else. So I don't think anybody at middleweight is going to be interesting enough for him to follow it. I mean, for the sake of winning a title and even maybe holding on to it. Yeah, maybe. Well, but I mean, other than Triple G, I don't see anybody, I guess, giving him the type of payday that he's asking for at this point.
Dazen might be interested, correct? If Triple G was to beat Munguia, Dazen might be interested. And then on the Jaime Munguia side, if he's to defeat Triple G, say it's one of the best fights that everyone's anticipating of the year, he's Mexican, he's undefeated. It just seems like the typical Floyd opponent. Like that's who Floyd's looking for, right? Takes a lot of punches, has absolutely no defense, can't move around the ring at all. He would never stop Floyd's jab. I don't, you know, that's the only win he needs. If Floyd gets that win and becomes a middleweight champ of the world, he's done it better than almost everyone in front of him. He did it his way, and he probably did it better. He undefeated, no blemish on his record at all, and went all the way to 160 to do it.
How about the other Charlo, the 160 Charlo? I know
he picks and chooses his guys, so I think he gets the chance. You know, the winner of that fight, Munguia versus Triple G, to me is going to be the leader of the doghouse, right? The guy in the middleweight division. Charlo's cool. I like Charlo, but you know what they said about Charlo in his last fight? He's still being tested, and that's not a champion. Champions aren't tested. Yeah. These two guys are champions, right? Munguia was a champion at junior middleweight. He moves to middleweight. He defeats Triple G. He's now a two-time champ. He's the real deal. He's undefeated, and he's brown. That makes for big dollars in Floyd's life. And he's beatable.
Yeah,
this isn't beautiful. A boxer.
Yeah.
This is not a boxer he's coming back for. If I'm Floyd, you got to be looking at it. You got to be calling at least Eddie Hearn and DAZN and going, hey, I'm just a tad bit interested in what you guys are offering. If those two are really fighting each other and Saul's, he's not coming back to middleweight. There's no clear boxer at middleweight that is you know, next to Floyd, like you say, maybe a Terence Crawford type fighter, right? Someone who's, man, if you come back, this guy's ultimately going to challenge you, and you don't want that. There's none of that at middleweight. I don't even think the Charlos scare Floyd, or Charlo brother, one brother that's there. I don't even think they scare him. So yeah, man, I'm just thinking when I seen Devin Haney put that, and I know he's doing a little exhibition fight with the fucking the YouTuber guy, but man, that would be a huge thing in Floyd's career if he came back for just one run at middleweight. But nah, that was just for the show. Go ahead, Lee.
All right. As a little note, because I like to promote everything everybody's working on, go to Etsy.com, ETSY.com. Former co-host and the only female member of the FightNet Radio staff, Rebecca Ryan Long. Look up Beck Hawaii, and you can get some of her products, being the outspoken person she is. She's basically turned every shitty thing that's happened over the last year, it seems, into some kind of product that you can personally own, including a collection of Bernie Sanders mugs saying, fuck this shit, which is kind of funny in the Rebecca world.
Nice.
So feel free to go and check out Rebecca's stuff. Free plug for former members. Hopefully all of the FightNet Radio team has a side hustle working somewhere doing something. See, I try to help everybody out. Go to FightNet Radio, available on Facebook at fight.net.radio. Check out Miguel Antonio Barragan at Fight Fiend Migs on both YouTube and the Instagrams. Andrew and I are both available on Facebook. I'm available on all social media platforms. We'd love for you to follow us and watch us and see what we're up to. If you were following me right now, you would see all the wonderful things that I'm doing in Hawaii without all of you guys. To me, that's the funniest thing in the world at the moment. Feel free, you know, jump on my page. I'll befriend you, and you can then look at photos of me having a blast in a place that you're not, which to me is funny. Sorry. Shout out to Sam Navajero, who apparently likes the fact that we've turned him into the official gelato, not ice cream,
gelato.
Andrew.
Gelato.
Yes. Fight Radio.
Gelato.
Yeah. Gelatitarian. He's a gelatitarian. Making gelato. And the official gelato of FightNet Radio. Check him out the next time you're in Australia. There you go. Shameless plugs for everybody. Andrew, you got a side hustle going? Somebody need, you know, air conditioning work or anything?
No, hell no. No, because then you're married to the job. I don't do any of that. Make enough at my work.
Miguel, only side hustle family, yet? Man. Got anything going? You willing to go shoot video of fighters, you know, for food or something? That would be funny.
Not quite. I have a couple of them on my YouTube channel. If you guys ever check out freshcleantees.com, happen to find anything you like, make sure to use the code MIGS15 at checkout, or check out Tactical Soap. Yeah, Tactical Soap. That's pheromone infused soap. You know, make sure to check them out. And if you find anything, make sure to use the code MIGS10 at checkout and get 10% off your total. Pow!
Wow. And if you own a small business,
I sell sex toys, Lee. I don't want to see anything, but he's got soap, so fuck it.
Homemade.
I think we should support, what is it? What's the one that gives you the free naughty gift at checkout?
Love or something? Or Adam?
Yeah, one of those. Like, I need to get them as a sponsor just because it would be funny every week. And this week's toy is a double-pronged dildo. One for the front, one for the back. We're
I have
a
GoFans
like
page only if you want to come see me.
Yes, for exclusive content.
That's my side hustle.
Start, you know what, Andrew? I'm starting one just for the sake of starting one. The Andrew LaPache.
Yeah.
I'm subscribing. I'll subscribe.
As you should. As you should. I'm not sure that we can get anybody to pay, but we'll do it for free. I'll get a live stream of maybe a cow in a barn or something and see how many people we get to follow. It'd be very funny. As I said before, you can follow all of us on social media.
Oh, I have some pigeons up in my roof. We can live stream them. I got to do some work. As soon as those fuckers are grown, they're out of there. I went up there. Dude, Lee, so I'm at home right now.
Yeah.
Right? I might as well tell you guys. Here's a little... What's it
insight.
Called?
Insight.
Yeah. You guys get a little bonus this week. So my son got sent home. Positive test in the classroom.
Oh, yeah. No, not positive on your son, just positive in the classroom.
So everyone gets locked down, right? So they call me. They call me, and I'm like, ah, shit. I better call my boss. Call my boss. They're like, get off the job site. You're fucking done. So I was on my way home, and I'm at home, and I hear this. It sounds like the drums. I don't know what the fuck these birds are doing up on my roof, but they're doing something. I'm here. I'm like, babe, what is that? She's like, it's every morning. It's every morning. You never hear it. It's every morning, blah, blah, blah. I go up there. There's four fucking pigeons living under my unit, under my ductwork. I got a rooftop unit on my house. They're living underneath the ductwork. They're babies, so they can't fly. I'm not a mean guy, right? So I'm going to allow them, because what's going on, it looks like fucking San Francisco underneath the bridges right now under my ductwork. They've been shitting there for, I don't know, months growing these two fuckers up. And it just, there's poop everywhere. So I got to get them out of there. But yeah, that's what's going on in my house right now. We're all on quarantine. You should, hey, you guys, when I got sent home, I was all immediately, I was like, we could go to the casino. We could go to the snow. And I was like, oh, wait, we're on quarantine. Fuck, we can't go anywhere. Yeah, it sucks, man. It's such a fucking buzzkill. But yeah, we're in like day three, day four. Everyone's fine. So I'm going to go take a test.
I've already looked it up for you. Look, there's pigeon repellent, bird be gone.
Yeah.
You can buy a giant owl. At Lowe's,
that's cool.
Tomcat, whatever that is, which would mean, I guess, buying a cat and chaining it to your roof. There's a bird barrier. It's an informative show.
The rooftop is it's only got, what are they, 4x4s probably that are holding it off the ground. So I'm thinking bricks, like three bricks, I think would take
care of it. Is this what it looks like, Andrew? Hold on, I got a photo. I mean, it's not your unit, but it's a picture of. Hold on, I gotta get this turned off. There we go.
Just a rooftop unit, commercial.
It's not a rooftop unit. It's hold on. Let me press play on that so you can see it. It's a bird up underneath. It's a pigeon, right? It's the shitty gray pigeon kind of pigeon.
Oh yeah. Right? Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
One of those. All right. So number one, shiny objects, Andrew. Shiny reflective objects make it problematic.
I'm gonna get predators. I'm gonna get a hawk. Fuck that.
Yeah, birds have many predators, including cats, owls, and larger birds of prey. That's the number two way to get rid of pigeon. So, yeah, a hawk's probably a good call. Garden balls. Here's my little Australian balls. You got big balls, we've got big balls, but garden balls are the biggest balls of all. That's a really funny AC/DC joke. Bird spikes.
They don't work.
Repellent sprays. You know what they left out was gun.
I thought about it, Lee. Can I say that? No, I don't have any guns. No.
You can say you have a gun if you legally own a gun.
Yeah, that's the whole thing. Hey. Can we scratch that last 5 minutes? Oh, jeez.
Let's edit that out.
Fightnet Radio is a show of comedy base, and nothing on this show is said in actuality. It is a show that is completely created out of entertainment for you, the masses. It's
trying to make you smile.
I am not Bob Arum. I am not Clarissa Shields. I am certainly not Oscar De La Hoya. The point of the show is not to make fun and or hurt anybody of any race, creed, color, or religion. It is simply for entertainment and education of boxing. The staff of Perfect Blue Studios would like to apologize for anything that was said on this show that might offend anybody, including the now defunct National Rifle Association. Did I cover it, Miguel? Did that sound thorough enough?
Yeah, that sounded good. Sounded pro. Right.
That's Miguel Antonio Barragan. That's Andrew Labouche, who may or may not be carrying. My name's Lee Honish, saying, yeah, why wouldn't you use a gun? And we will see you guys next week.
Yeah, decision I made when I was 19 years old,